seagoing out their cargoes of oil. The cargoes which they've carried in bulk from distant purchase. At docksides and quays, in large ports and little harbours, their characteristic outlines are familiar. When the shore pipeline through which the oil flowed had been disconnected, the tankers turn round and set off along the sea routes, which take them back to the refinery at Abadan. And while their great tanks are being refilled, they're tied up at the quay not far from the Huzistian. She's one of the smaller ships belonging to the oil company, and carries oil in tins, not in bulk like her larger sister. For more than a quarter of a century, she's been plugging Abadan and the little ports which lie along the coast of the Persian Gulf. Into her narrow hold, the tins are lowered and packed so that each layer is separated from the next by a reed mat to protect them from damage. The passage is sometimes a rough one, and the hatches are battened down as securely as if the Huzistian were setting out across the North Sea. The sun is setting as the Huzistian leaves Abadan. She's a slow boat, and it'll take her 4 days to make this journey. 4 long days in the relentless, blistering heat, steaming slowly down the gulf within sight of the sun-dried rocks and villages of the coast. 4 monotonously hot days, the tedium broken only by an occasional visitor seeking refuge from the perpetual glare of sun and sea. When she reaches her main port of call, the Huzistian gives a blast in her siren to warn those on shore of her arrival. The waters of the gulf are so shallow that even the little Huzistian cannot get close inshore. And the native stevedores have a long row when early next morning they come out to start unloading. All the work is done by hand, as it was with the cargoes of long ago, when petrol was undreamed of, and mechanization an unknown word. All that day, the dhows are rowed backwards and forwards across the strip of water separating the ship from the sandy bay. And all day, the tins are carried from the dhows through the waves that break gently on the hot shore. These men of the little coastal villages make their living by diving for pearls, catching and curing fish, and growing melons and dates. But they welcome the extra work which comes with the arrival of the oil boat. And the oil which they carry up the beach to be stored has brought many changes into their lives. There's kerosene for the lamps, and petrol for the lorry, fuel for the little power station, and aviation spirit for the desert airstrip a few miles inland. Her cargo unloaded, the Huzistian leaves the sweltering coast and sets course back to Abadan. There she'll reload for another journey down the gulf, tying up once again under the shadow of the great oil tankers, which are preparing for their voyages across the world. Walking across the quiet English country, you may hear an unusual sound from the skies. And almost before you can see it, an aeroplane has passed overhead. That, you say to yourself, must have been a jet. It may have been a pure jet, like the de Havilland Vampire fighter. To civil aviation, the pure jet offers the advantage of great speed, and is at its best at high altitudes and over long distances. But it's uneconomic for shorter distances, mainly because of its high fuel consumption during possible delays whilst waiting to land. For such journeys, the Vickers Viscount has been designed. It gets its power from jet turbines plus propellers, or turboprops. and is fitted with four Rolls-Royce Dart engines. They give more power for less weight and have a much smaller frontal area than the conventional piston engines, and the Viscount can still gain height if one of them is stopped. Having no reciprocating parts, they run exceptionally smoothly, and since noise and vibration are the two main causes of fatigue, both to the pilot and the passengers, these engines are important to mental and physical comfort. Inside the aircraft, when it's flying, the engines are almost inaudible, and the lack of vibration prolongs the life of the airframe itself, as well as that of the various instruments. The Viscount is the first turbine-engine aircraft in the world to be awarded the British Normal Certificate of Airworthiness, and on her first tour beyond the British Isles, she visited most of the European capitals. Paris was the last stop on the tour, and when news of her arrival reached the airfield, people began to gather, waiting for her to come in. Important air officials and Paris journalists were anxious to try out the advantages of this new airliner for themselves. And for 2 days, a series of short trips was made from the airfield. The Viscount flies on in-turbine fuel. This fuel is quite different from the ordinary aviation spirit, and stocks of it were ready before the Viscount arrived. The care is always taken in refueling aircraft, and it's essential that the fuel be very clean. Fine particle filtration is being fitted to all the new aircraft fuelers, and the system on the French airfield uses a pair of canisters holding alternate nylon and paper discs. The aviation turbine fuel is passed through this filter, which is replaced by a clean one as often as necessary. The fuel tanks of the Viscount are in the wings, and it only takes 10 minutes to refuel the aircraft completely. The Viscount stayed 3 days in France, and then set off for home. Her tour had successfully demonstrated Britain's lead in civil air, and now she flies smoothly over the Channel, showing her power and grace before she comes down to land in England again.
Like any other here on Southampton water, with the smell of work to be done. It isn't the gayest or smartest part of the Channel coast. Nothing fashionable about Hamble. Only tank farms and jetties and busy men. And the oil barge called attendant. 4 miles down from the port storage depot. Oil comes to Hamble by sea and leaves by land and sea. For part of its function is the bunkering of Southampton's big ships. A great marine filling station for some of the largest vessels afloat. Every day, the attendant heads up the water for Southampton, a well-known, if not especially elegant, figure, to do her job as a floating fuel supply for the traffic of the ocean. 4 miles to go to work, along a stretch of water that is one of the main approach roadsteads of the near sea, past the clean lines of the great ships from remote places, taking her plodding workaday shape among the liners like an oil truck among the limousines. Someone else is busy today, a renowned and imposing old friend. Familiar and famous, the big, beautiful bulk of the Queen Elizabeth. So vast that she must hurry to move out on the full tide, making way for another, something new, something none of us here have seen before, that for 4 days has been driving eastward through the Atlantic and across the headlines of two nations, 53,000 tons of her at 40 miles an hour. Southampton has seen them come and go, This port, more than any other, takes enormous ships for granted. But today the outriders are off with a first especial welcome. All the little ships, everything floating or sailing, from tugs to the Isle of Wight packet, out to meet the ship that has taken the record from the Queen Mary after 14 years. For the Atlantic is Southampton's personal pond. And a liner that links the Ambrose Light and Bishop Rock in 3.5 days is not going to come to our harbor without a very big hand. And here she is, looking at England for the first time. And England looking at her. The liner United States, with the blue ribbon in her pocket and the world's applause still rippling into her radio room. Size isn't everything, not to Southampton, nor is speed. And if the United States costs 25 million pounds, that is America's business. But the Atlantic record is to Southampton in a way what the Derby is to Epsom or the Ashes to Lord's. In the last 100 years, it has been broken 29 times. By the Americans, by the British, the Germans, the Italians, the French, and now by America again. That makes it a day to bring out the bunting and wake up the tartan. About 4,000 people have grandstand seats for the big entrance. But it's a fair guess that most of Southampton is here or hereabouts. Before. Well, this was a good way to see it. I don't know what we'd expected. I guess maybe we thought that Southampton's reception might not be quite so grand for a stranger who had slipped 10 hours and a bit off the British time. You may figure that maybe Southampton might be feeling, well, just a bit sore. Sore? Hell, this landfall was really something. We all reckoned we'd had a pretty sensational send-off from New York, but the reception your end, no kidding, even better. Sure, we had a good trip. We had an up-to-date ship, all right. Yes, sir. Only bit of timber aboard is the piano. Those 165,000 horsepower, they slipped us across so fast that after Bishop Rock, we just had to hang around while our schedule caught up on us. Here we are, and everybody aboard, from Margaret Truman to me, felt we couldn't have asked for a more generous welcome.